Hey Ben, it's James. How are you doing?
all good.
Yeah, not too bad. Seem to have got myself a little bit lost. Did take a bit of a shortcut, and so I'm probably going to be a bit later than planned. But there we go. I was going to ask you, were you planning to go to the Reelies tonight? Yeah, I know, me neither. And I'm trying to think of an excuse to get myself out of it, to be honest with you. Well, this is the thing. Nobody watches it, and, you know, it's meaningless compared to the Oscars or the BAFTAs and even the Golden Globes, to be honest with you. So, yeah, I'm not really sure if I can be bothered. And, of course, you've got the added problem with the fact that I've got to spend time with Harrison, which is always a challenge, and Chris can be quite hard work as well, so...
Please, can we not do a fumbled envelope joke?
For anything.
I have a clapperboard if you want to use the clapperboard.
Oh!
For novelty value.
Yes, novelty.
I want to do this.
That's what we're all about.
This is what I want to do.
Wheel of Pins is back, baby.
You got this, Harrison.
What?
Oh, yeah.
This
will be fun.
Hello! And.
Hi and welcome back to Real Opinions. This is the third annual Reelies.
Reelies. You've already fucked it up.
This is the third annual Reelies. You're going through all the categories. We've tallied all of our... Well, Harrison's tallied all of them. And so we've all given our top three in each category, which are basically all the same as the Oscar categories, right?
Yeah, so we use the majority of the technical categories and the acting categories. Basically anything that people might care about. So there's no short documentaries or anything. And the films that...
Triggered!
The films that are eligible are basically from the last Reelies we did until now. So it's not necessarily Oscar season, because it goes up until...
It's March till March.
It's more or less March till March.
It's
so
around
UK
Deadpool
well.
Until now.
What Ben said.
Just from the last, Fox film
to the most recent
Fox
X-Men exactly.
Film.
And if you don't care about certain categories, in the comments there'll be timestamps leading to the categories.
Leading to the scat section.
Why would you want to miss this award-winning chat?
But when it gets onto something like the
when you're on your
third
or fourth
category
watch,
is going to be a
and you've got your favourite quote. When you're watching it with your friends
to
for the fifth time, you know you want
to
move.
I usually don't even do it in a logical way of category, what we're talking about. Where's the next inside joke I can put a timestamp to? Okay, so are we ready to go?
Yeah.
Oh, wait, you don't need to clap. Yeah, okay.
We did the clap.
We're good to go.
Okay, so the first thing that we're going to open with is supporting actress, because the supporting actor category is a complete clusterfuck. And I'm trying to put that one off for as long as I can. So, in terms of this one, this was probably one of the most consistent ones in terms of what people nominated. We basically nominated the same things, just in different orders. So the nominees are Allison Williams for Get Out, Daphne Little Girl from Logan, and Anugura Rice.
So this is the straightforward category.
you can't say words, can you?
The little girl from The Nice Guys.
Angry Rice. That one.
Angry Rice.
Angry Rice.
She's Australian, isn't it?
Angry Rice from The Nice Guys. The woman from Moonlight, what's her name?
Naomi Harris.
Naomi Harris. And Michelle Williams from Manchester by the Sea.
Right.
Okay. And the winner, by quite a long way for this one, is Allison Williams from Get Out.
Fair enough.
There we go. Which is
I feel like I was saw the most
recently.
I didn't include her in mine, and I feel bad now. Oh. She was really good.
She was the
really
top good. Of two people's yeah. lists.
Yeah.
So I think that's why. She is really good, isn't
she?
Mm. She's
top of my list, but she was
no.
quite prominent. Yeah.
No, she wasn't. So, she's very
so,
good.
Should we briefly describe her role?
That's what you're too briefly describe her.
Yes.
How attractive she is.
But it is a little difficult because of spoiler reasons.
Yeah,
yeah
exactly.
But she is the main character's girlfriend in the film. And I guess, like, I think me and Jack were talking about it, and she does have really good chemistry with the lead.
Yeah.
Like, they have a believable relationship,
yeah.
and you do care for them. And then as the film goes on, there's a whole other element to her character, and she basically becomes the most interesting person in the film by quite some way. And she's the funniest moment in the film.
Yeah.
By and it's such a nondescript, sort of stupid moment, just involving cereal.
Oh, I love that!
But
yeah.
it is funny. So,
it's like racism visual metaphor in a nutshell. Yeah.
But that was the winner for that one. Very good.
Yay!
Well
done.
Well done.
Awesome.
Well done.
So far, it
is going...
Feel
free to come and collect your awards.
Yeah!
And then exit on the right, just off stage. Okay,
unfortunately,
Alison
couldn't be here today.
So it is going awkward and babbly, and it feels very unprofessional and rehearsed, but it's still going better than the Oscars. So we're fine. Next up is original screenplay. The nominee, again, fairly similar sort of nominees. What we have here is Train to Busan.
Why it is in English.
Why are you staring at me?
It is in English. I don't know why you're reading it like it's a different language.
La La Land.
Uh-huh.
The Nice Guys.
Mm-hmm.
And I, Daniel Blake.
Mm-hmm.
And the winner, by possibly the biggest margin of anything in this whole thing, is La La Land.
Yeah.
Which I think is good, because I think... A lot of people kind of ignore La La Land's screenplay because it's a musical and the songs are more important, but it is a good screenplay.
Yeah.
The dialogue's good, the characters are strong.
The little insults they have are really cute.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I think that La La Land actually deserves that, and I think it's nice that we didn't go for a certain other film that only one person voted for.
It's fine. If only one person voted for something, I don't think it should be nominated. It's
no.
Like
no.
That.
Yeah.
Are you trained to Busaning?
No, I was talking about Manchester by the Sea.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay.
So, sound editing, nominees, Kong Skull Island, Hacksaw Ridge, Arrival, and Rogue One.
What? That's Swiss Army Man. To be fair, I only voted for Swiss Army Man because someone had to mix in some farts. And it made me laugh. Someone had to come up with the sounds for farts.
And Swiss Army Man.
Thank you.
Someone out there had to make a sound for farting without actually farting into a microphone, okay?
And the winner was not the farting, it was Hacksaw Ridge, which could have done with the farting in it, I think, to lighten the mood.
We should do a re-edit and just add in.
Every time it's someone's
head. Extended it. Extended edit, more farts.
Made the first hour of the film more entertaining.
Did they?
Yeah.
Yes. Did they... With Swiss Army Man, are they different fart sounds? Is it like, you know, like in Raging Bull, every punch is a different punch?
It's a series of different
it's
farts.
A different, so they,
yeah.
someone records well, different
farts.
Would
you love how
we managed
to get
same fart again and again?
No, but they might reuse some farts.
Right.
So it was different farts.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And
that,
some
that
farts
makes me
are
kind
like
of
fiery farts.
Okay.
And, yeah.
Just want to remind everyone that cinema is an art form.
But no, Hacksaw Ridge's sound, I think
that's great.
Everyone agrees it was really good.
And that guy finally won his Oscar. Was that
mixing? I think he was nominated for sound editing as well, if I'm not mistaken.
Right.
But he won it for mixing.
Yeah, and he's been nominated like 20 odd times or something.
Yeah, he had a longer snub run than Roger Deakins has had.
Wow.
But no one gives a shit because it's sound, so fucking nerd. Next up is sound mixing. The nominees for sound mixing are La La Land, Rogue One, Train Spotting.
T2.
I'm not calling it T2.
Train
Hacksaw Ridge and Arrival. And the winner is Hacksaw Ridge.
Again.
Probably reasonable.
Probably for the exact same reason.
It had sounds.
Next up,
and a lot of them, they were mixed.
Next up, I have put animated film, because I think this
right.
is a fairly big one with us.
My animated.
So the nominees for Best Animated Film are Kubo and the Two Strings, Your Name, Moana, Zootopia, and Lego Batman. And Sausage Party. No one everyone forgot Sausage Party.
I remembered Sausage Party.
And the winner is Moana.
Yay!
Which I did not expect to win this one.
Really?
I thought Kubo was going to win because you're all second. And you're like
I didn't
obsessed.
Did you like it as well?
Oh, I didn't see it.
Who else voted for Kubo?
You both.
I really wanted to see it, but I was.
It's awesome, isn't it?
Yeah, I liked it.
No, but Moana won.
Moana is really, 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 really good. It was like a very close second for me. So.
Kubo and Zootopia are actually tied on this one.
Zootopia was
in second place, but Moana won by quite a bit. I guess it was just because we all liked it. Second,
I expected to be very bored and kind of a bit like, oh, another Disney movie, but I really enjoyed it.
It's my favorite of
the three
three likewise. Princess ones. I think it's much, much more fun than Tangled, which is kind of a boring film.
Yeah.
And it's more consistent than Frozen. Like, Frozen has some really good moments, but there's also things like the troll song that's just crap. But Moana is just consistently great. And it looks beautiful,
lovely.
Too. I know that Kubo looks amazing because it's stop motion, but Moana... I'm gonna say it again, but the water in Moana is incredible.
Talk about the water.
No, but the water in Moana is possibly the best.
Okay.
It's possibly
best
my number
than water
the
itself.
Single greatest animated thing ever.
Jack thinks I always talk about animated water.
About water. Whenever it's anything animated and water, you always talk about how great the water is.
It was good.
To be fair, liquid is quite hard to do.
It's hard to do. Yeah.
Whenever you see it in games, it always bothers me in games. Like in GTA, whenever anyone drinks anything. The liquid looks so awful every time.
But only if the waves in GTA look good.
Eh.
Okay. Well, next up is cinematography, which is a very diverse... I'm going to read everything that people nominated for cinematography, because it's quite hard to sort of separate. Nothing that's actually came up did that badly, so I feel they're all viable nominees. Arrival.
Mm-hmm.
Skull Island.
Mm-hmm.
Kong, Skull Island, Monkey. Lion.
Yeah.
Pausing
for reaction on everyone.
La La Land. Hail Caesar. Moonlight. Get Out.
That was my reaction
to Moonlight being nominated. and Rogue One. I looked at you because I remember you saying that you hated the color grading in Lion, and I thought
different from cinematography.
No, but I thought it might just because you didn't like how the film looked at all. It might just made you angry.
Can I just ask James? Did you put Hail Caesar because of Roger Deakins?
I put Hail Caesar because it's got one of the... It may not be one of the best films of the year, but it has some of the best cinematography of the year. So yes, I did put Hail Caesar. And it just so happened that the demigod of the cinematography world, Roger Deakins, was responsible for that. Didn't do that many films this year, did he? So maybe next year.
I don't know.
He's doing the new Blade Runner film. So
That's
going to be better. Amazing, get an Oscar
trailer alone looks incredible. Mm.
And for this one, we have a tie.
Woo!
A two-way tie between Arrival,
mm-hmm.
for some reason, and La La Land.
Yeah.
Arrival cinematography was fine.
It was great.
It was great.
When you think about how many of the effects they had to put into the image, and the image still looked great as well.
It was okay.
It wasn't Roger Deakins.
It wasn't as good as
Sicario. Deakins, but not this one.
No. Well, La La Land was the other nominee, and I think that won.
Warren Beatty didn't have a laptop with him. I think
Skull Island deserves like a big head.
No, Skull Island, but obviously you were the person who put Skull Island.
Yeah.
And it does look most of the time. There are a few parts where I think it looks a little cheap, but I don't necessarily think that's the cinematography's fault.
I think,
but there are definitely some really striking images.
Definitely.
A lot of the time, because so many of those images are like full-on special effects as well.
Yeah, that's all why I didn't nominate
it. Usually they look really like dodgy and stuff, but especially when you're like your main character is a gigantic CGI ape, they make it look so good around.
Everything that I remember cinematography wise is from the first initial helicopter
attack.
And I remember lots of shots there going like, "Ooh, that's cool." Yeah. Not there's Godzilla cool, but cool.
There's a lot of stuff later on that's cooler as well, like with the napalm and the like. I won't say too much just in case I'm spoiling it. But...
No, yeah, I definitely say like for a VFX heavy blockbuster, it gets a lot of really nice shots in and stuff like that. So it's very pretty for a kind of one that.
Yeah,
they don't necessarily have to go to those lengths.
Exactly.
Okay, this is my one I like. This is best original score.
Right.
Okay, so the nominees for best original score were Kubo and the Two Strings, La La Land, Moonlight, Moana, and Get Out. There's so many is because people put lots of these quite high, so it's quite different. Rogue One? Who put Rogue One? Was it James?
It was good.
It was okay. I love Michael Giacchino. He's like my guy, but I don't know. It was just a bit...
It didn't really feel like Michael Giacchino, though. It felt like Michael Giacchino pretending to be John Williams.
He had to do it in 6 weeks because... Alexander
deserves the award.
Well, that's true. Because Alexander Desplat was supposed to do it originally.
Really?
And then he left the project. He left the project like 6 weeks before the film came out.
Yeah.
And Michael Giacchino all of a sudden was composing for it. No one knows any more than that. And I thought, it was decent. And Arrivals is good too.
I like Arrival.
Hate that and that, you know, that opening emotional theme.
I like that.
I think it's more just because it feels like it was taken from the one that I think was Theory of Everything. It feels like the exact same track, like the emotional falling in love track.
There's so much mix between like emotional stuff and like really dark,
the alien
stuff,
themes
like on Sicario.
Like the sort of ethereal when I say alien sounding, I mean like alien sounding in the sense like it doesn't sound human, like recognizable.
Yeah.
That score stuff is really good. I just didn't like the emotional part of the score, but that's besides the point because the winner's La La Land.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. As you'd expect.
Fair.
Yeah.
Which I'm happy about because I think that it's my favourite score of the 2010s?
Oh, the decade so far.
Yeah, it's my favourite score of this decade thus far. Because, you know, Epilogue, final track, I adore that track. It's more it's probably my favourite part of the soundtrack, actually. Mm. More so than any of the songs, but I think it is genuinely beautiful. You remember when you talked about like how her was beautiful in all the senses of the word? That's what you said. You said it very pretentious.
That sounds pretentious even for me. So I don't say that.
You did say that about her in our first video when you were all yelling at me.
Yeah.
And that is how I feel about that epilogue sequence. Just like it's beautiful in all senses of the word, and I do think that the epilogue music is a good part of that.
Harrison's so capable of feeling.
It's really nice.
You've had like a happy I was like, I love this film. It sounds great.
And Get Out was really good as well.
Yeah.
I like the opening credit music when they're driving in the car. That was cool.
Didn't really think about Get Out score, but thinking back, it was
good.
There was a shame about all the stuff that they like inserted in for jump scares, but
yeah,
that's not the score.
It comes with the Blumhouse.
It's
label
more like
and stuff.
Like you said, you could basically said it's more like sound effects.
It's not like if you got the soundtrack album, there'd just be a track that was like a jump scare. And the next track. So next we have editing.
Right.
Editing. And for editing, our nominees are Hacksaw Ridge, La La Land, Arrival, John Wick 2, and Nocturnal Animals. And the winner is Hacksaw Ridge again.
Woo!
Yeah. It's all for that second half.
Yeah. Oh, I have been treating Hacksaw Ridge as if it is a two-part film for this whole thing.
What about that dishonourable mention you were talking about?
Yes! Dishonourable mention!
Yeah.
I bet you're really excited.
Should we all just try and say the name of the film at the same time? Like,
okay.
Three, two, one.
Suicide Squad!
Oh, what a surprise!
What a fucking clusterfuck.
Hey, yeah. I like the Slipknot cut. Have you seen the Slipknot cut?
The Slipknot cut?
That adds so much depth to his character.
it's like a minute long.
You're
the lucky one amongst us.
We can explain to James. So, Suicide Squad went through, there was like 10 different versions.
Yeah.
Clearly, they had no fucking idea what they were doing. They panicked, and they got like the trailer house to cut the film. I think that's the version that we saw. Is that the version we saw?
Yeah, trailer house.
And it is just like such a mess of like 10-second scenes that are, you can't even call them. There aren't scenes
like
in this
music
film.
Video
it's
just introductions of characters.
Yeah,
like
every single
conjoined
thing feels like it was originally a scene, and now it's just like someone walks into a room and goes hello, and then someone else does a like a video game character select pose, and then it just goes on to the next scene. It's such a monumental mess in that sense.
Yeah.
They try and squeeze in a romance right at the beginning as well, but they then forget about the film.
I've already forgotten about that.
Exactly. the flag and Enchantress.
June
Moon.
It's such a mess that there's a whole chunk of the film that's character introductions, and like it's all a waste of time because half of them are never seen again, and most of them are irrelevant. But for some reason, Will Smith's character gets like 4 introductions. It's like you meet him, then we meet him again, then there's a montage where we meet everyone and they meet him again.
They throw in Batman as much as they can as well. Like at some points, he's just really not needed at all. And they're just like, oh, here was a moment where Batman met Harley Quinn for absolutely no reason at all.
I would also say, and I know that this would be controversial, but I would also say that Jason Bourne had horrific editing. Because the other Bourne films do the quick cutting, but they're coherent.
Mm.
But Jason Bourne was just like, "What the fuck is going on?"
That's the thing. I didn't have much of a problem with Jason Bourne, but then again, I was expecting absolutely nothing.
So was I. But I was expecting nothing. I was expecting to see.
And I keep forgetting that I even saw it. So, I mean, it didn't have an overwhelmingly negative effect on me in any of the elements, but I just didn't really register the fact that it existed a lot of the time.
But Hacksaw Ridge was good.
Yeah, it was
good. Next up, should we go to one of the more important categories again?
Do we want to just check that everything's okay with the camera?
Yeah.
Good idea.
I'm just going to have a drink. Does anyone want to drink
something?
So, up next
is adapted screenplay, which I don't think we've already done, but if we have, we'll cut that out.
We haven't.
Choose the better one of the two.
So the nominees for adapted screenplay are Logan, Arrival, Hunt for the Wilder People. That confused me because it was written down as just Wild. Wild? Nocturnal Animals. I nearly said Nocturnal Amules. John Wick. I don't know why I've written that. He's at this point, I must be getting really annoyed at this. John Wick's Lego Batman and David Brent. Life on the Road. And the winner just is Arrival.
There we go.
Just
I can't say I'm surprised.
Logan
was close.
Logan was my number one.
Logan was my number one.
How did David Brent fare?
You were the only person who picked David
Brent. He might come back later.
Again, the music's good, but the rest of the film's like.
So Arrival.
Yeah,
it's good.
It's really good.
It was good. There we go. Fuck it.
Well, I think we had varying differences with how he thought, like, it got towards the end with the more montage-y sections. The bits, like the scenes where she's explaining language and kind of when it gets more into the nitty-gritty of its subject matter, it's a lot. It's one of the more enjoyable written scenes of the year.
It deals with some, like, really far-out stuff really well as well. Like, I was never sat there like, hang on a minute, what? Go back. I need you to explain that again. It was
that
very succinct, very cleverly done.
Yeah, that's true.
Succinctness, I think, is a perfect way to describe it. Like, because sci-fi is when they deal with big themes and stuff and get really exposition heavy. None of that with Arrival,
that's
which
true.
Is really nice and clean and fresh.
Yeah, I can agree with that.
Clean and
evidently
clean
so do the rest of them.
Lean,
yeah.
I guess is what I was trying to say. It's a lean screenplay.
Clean and fresh.
So next up we have supporting actor.
Right, the cluster part.
So this is the one where I'm just going to read a fucking list of names. So the nominees were Jake Gyllenhaal. I believe that was for Nocturnal Animals. Yeah. Jake Gyllenhaal, Boyd Holbrook.
Who?
He's the main guy, Logan. Not the main guy, the robot.
The villain guy.
I like him. So, Ben Foster for the bank robbery shooty.
Hello,
Highway. That one. Ben Foster.
No,
I remember.
Oh, it's you.
No, it was
no
me.
I didn't.
Oh, but
I
okay.
I thought he was better than Jeff Bridges, who was the one who was nominated for the Oscar. I thought he was more deserving.
Supporting actor?
Chris
Pine is the star.
Yeah.
I wouldn't have even said anyone was the lead. It was all kind of like...
I think he was better than Jeff Bridges.
Ben Foster was the best thing
about
just
it. Jeff Bridges.
Hugo Weaving for Hacksaw Ridge. He was good.
Oh, he was good.
He
no,
was good.
Right.
Thank
he
you,
was,
Jack.
He was,
was
genuinely
yeah.
good.
Yeah.
He was
the
best
like a
actor
wild
in the film.
Out of nowhere.
Yeah.
I forgot he was in it.
He was the best actor in the
thank
entire
you. That bit
no,
where
no
he's,
I disagree with that.
That's
but...
the bit where he's at the dinner table and he's kind of like crying about, because he's like yelling at his son for wanting to
the problem
off
is
board.
You picked an actor from the boring part of the film.
Yes,
so
but he made the boring part of the film
manageable.
Manageable, exactly. Yeah.
Actually, I do completely agree with your point. Yeah, I don't know where you put it in your top three.
No, he's number one. My bottom.
Okay,
I'm sorry, Jack, I can't say his name, but the man from Moonlight.
Mahershala Ali.
Mahershala
it's
Ali.
I didn't know how to say his
like,
name until he won the Oscar.
Impeccable pronunciation.
It's
very similar
like,
in how
I wish I said that at the Oscars.
Yeah.
Just got up and went, I don't know how to say his name. For you.
You.
Moonlight, alright? Moonlight.
But I thought it's a very similar way to Hugo Weaving. Mm. He was only in the third of the film, but he was the best actor of the entire thing, even though he was just a sporting guy.
And again, Jack, Lucas Hedges?
Yeah, that was
his name?
Guess.
I got it. Lucas
although
Hedges.
I'd probably replace it with Hugo Weaving.
Yes, Hugo. Charlton Copley for Free Fire.
Okay.
Christopher Lloyd for the film you picked him for?
I am not a serial killer. Basically, I was really struggling, and Christopher Lloyd finally plays a character where he's not just Doc from Back to the Future, and he's kind of this weird human alien thing, and he's really, really good in it. So, yeah, exactly. Where did
am I supposed to know this before the film comes out?
It's a major part of the book, which I didn't even know going in, so I didn't know either. But there you go.
He's an alien.
Let's see if he won.
I'm not a serial killer.
Patrick Stewart for Logan.
Right.
Sam Neill for Hunt for the Wilder People.
Right.
I put Wilder. Now, there was two for Hail Caesar. There was Ralph Fiennes.
He's putting fucking Hail Caesar!
And then there was Han Solo.
Yeah.
How do you say his name?
Alden Rickman.
Han Solo.
Hinrichsen.
Young Han Solo.
Now, the winner is a tie.
Oh, good. Because it wasn't
between Alden Heinrichsen.
Between Patrick Stewart and Sharlto Copley.
Yay! Oh.
Yeah, that
I thought that was completely out of nowhere.
Sharlto Copley as well?
I put Sharlto Copley as like number three.
I didn't put Sharlto Copley.
That does feel like a very kind of real
opinions
one,
so. Kind of pair of winners for that category.
Yeah. It wasn't a particularly great performance, but it wasn't that good.
He
does comedy very well, and he was the funniest character.
Weirdly enough, I didn't actually put this, but I was going to put at one point Sharlto Copley for Hardcore Henry as one of my... He was entertaining. He was a good character.
Because
he plays all those different characters, and he is basically
they're all the same character.
No, they have different accents. He's anchoring you into the film. They're just different outfits.
That's like Homer Simpson showing up and saying all of his lines in slowly different accents. It's a different character.
Because people complain that film didn't have any personality and it was just action scenes. But I thought he gave it personality.
There was personality.
Yeah.
He was good. Right, well, whatever. He won for the other film anyway. Yeah. Fucking hell. Now, song.
Best song.
Best song. Okay.
Okay.
We have nominees for song Slough from David Brent, Life on the Road.
Can I just say before this, I didn't realise David Brent was eligible. I totally forgot, and I would have probably put Slough in mine as well.
You see? And it could have won.
Slough could have won. It's equidistant between London and Reading. Oh, Slough.
My kind of town, I don't. Life on the Road from David Brent. Life on the Road. Drive It Like You Stole It from Sing Street. Shiny from Moana. How Far I'll Go from Moana. It calls me, and no one knows how far it goes. If the wind in my sail on the sea stays behind me, one day I'll know. If I go, there's just no telling how far I'll go. The coconut song from, what's it called? It's called, Where You Are, that's the consider its trees, each part of the coconut, that's all we need. We make our nets from the fibers, the water is sweet inside. We use the leaves to build fires, cook up the meat inside. Consider the coconuts, the trunks and the leaves.
The island gives us what we need.
That's right. Someone in the crowd. Day of a lovely night for love.
You say there's nothing here. Well, let's make something clear. I think I'll be the one to make that call.
What's your call?
And though you looked so cute in your polyester suit,
it's wool.
You're right. I'd never fall for you at all. And maybe this appeals to someone not in heels or to any girl who feels there's some chance the romance. I'm frankly feeling nothing.
Is that so?
Or it could be less than nothing.
Good to know, so you agree.
That's right.
What a waste of a lovely night.
And the winner?
So not actually the one that was actually nominated.
No, from no, no neither yeah. of the songs no. that were nominated from
so
Ireland.
So overrated, you know.
the winner's tie. It's a tie between Another Day of Sun and Someone in the Crowd.
Good.
Because of me yeah. and you, basically, because no one else picked the same songs except me and you. Okay. We had them the other way around from each other. So that's why good. The two La 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 songs
I would
won.
Go for so Someone in the Crowd.
Someone in the Crowd.
I would pick that one over.
Yeah, for another day of
Sun as well. So there
which,
you go.
Wait, which one is your favourite?
City of Stars is my favourite.
I like it. Out of those two, to like be deciding vote out of. Oh, wait, no, it's already. 3-2
regardless. Yes. But I didn't cast a vote on that category actually, so I'm gonna say not Another Day of Sun.
So okay. Someone in the Crowd.
Someone
won.
In the Crowd.
There we go. Okay.
And can I just say, because it's a film that will now probably not be mentioned, but I would like to mention David Brent Malcolm Road. We're saying it's not necessarily
you
the
really
best film of
Jack
the year.
Shit last
not,
year, didn't you?
Not the best film of the year, but the songs are brilliant. And the reason why we should acknowledge it is because it's the kind of film that will get ignored by the BAFTAs and certainly by all of the American awards. And
I mean, the songs are very, very, very funny.
Are,
very
one
funny.
That yeah.
I wanted to mention for this that I didn't... It was probably my fourth pick, but I didn't put it in, was actually Evermore from Beauty and the Beast, which is the only good song in the new Beauty and the Beast film, and it's the original one.
I would agree with you on that, James.
It's the best song, and it's the one that isn't actually pre-existing, because they mess up most of the pre-existing songs, but the one... original one that's actually memorable is really good.
Yeah.
Dan Stevens is the best singer in that whole film.
I wouldn't say it's the
far.
Fourth
yeah.
best. Like, out of, like,
maybe it wouldn't have been,
it
would
like,
probably, but I mean, just,
it
I
was the
to
best
mention
song
it.
In that film, mm-hmm. I agree.
Any dishonourable mentions for song?
Suicide Squad. Sorry to...
Is there an original song in
this? There's that 21 Pilot Heathens shit
show. Oh, God.
And then there's that Sucker for... Then there's that Sucker for Pain one, where it's like, 10 people featuring on it, and like they each get to sing a fucking line because they're sharing a 3-minute song. And there's genuinely a part in it where Lil Wayne sings about eating jellyfish on toast. And that is genuinely a lyric in there because you need something to rhyme with toast. It's fucking awful. No. Toast is the jellyfish on toast. So toast is the thing that rhymes with something.
Oh right.
I don't know why
jellyfish on toast rhymes with toast.
I don't remember what it rhymes with, but I would say those Suicide Squad songs.
Yeah.
My dishonourable mention would be.
Oh God, Zootopia.
Oh, it's because I want Zootopia.
The fucking Shakira song.
Yeah,
forgot about that.
Giselle, you mean?
Actually, the Lego Batman song was all right.
Oh,
it wasn't. It wasn't good, but it wasn't bad.
No.
Did you not like it?
No, I mean Lego Batman.
I only just about tolerated it.
Really?
But like, it felt like to me like the worst parts of the most obvious juvenile, like irreverent jokes from the Lego movie turned into the feature film. Like, oh, what if Batman rapped? That'd be funny. No, it wouldn't. Well, that's the whole fucking film. Next up, we have production design. The nominees for production design are La La Land, Hail Caesar, Arrival, Kubo and the Two Strings, Rogue One, and The Nice Guys. Sorry, I couldn't tell where the break between the categories was. And The Nice Guys.
Right.
And the winner, again, by 1 point, is Rogue One.
Hey.
Oh. Yeah.
I think that was the one I voted for Rogue One for, just because I like how they like retrofitted all of the special effects. Like, they made it look like the 70s. Like the special effects from A New Hope, which I really
enjoyed. Yeah, that's true. Yeah, actually,
that was the attention
to
detail.
And I found it so much better, the production design, than The Force Awakens, actually. Like,
really?
Yes, yeah, absolutely. The armor and like stuff, like you were saying, seems much more.
There's more texture to it.
Yeah, exactly. Whatever it was, it's the texture and the surfaces seem much more rugged, like how they are in the originals.
There was actually, my go-to thing is, there's actually buttons to push rather than just some projected thing in midair that you go blah, 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 blah.
The thing is, like, I think I've said that I didn't love Rogue One, but I nominated it for quite a few categories here, because it's like the thing that Chris was saying, like, just because you didn't like the film necessarily doesn't mean that
it's not
warranted to those categories, and I did actually put it down as one of these. It only just, by 1 point, beat out La La Land and The Nice Guys, which are tied for second place. Yeah.
Both mentioned for Nice Guys in case it doesn't come back up again.
I feel like The Nice Guys is consistently second place in this.
Yeah.
It's second place in many things. Next up, we have special effects. I think this might be second to last technical category. And the nominees are Rogue One, Jungle Book, Arrival, Ghost in the Shell, Doctor Strange, Kubo and the Two Strings, and Kong Skull Island. And the winner is Kong Skull Island, which is, I agree with you. Yeah, the skull crawler and Kong fight at the end, the skull crawler looks almost full photo real there.
Yeah.
The big, like, the queen skull crawler or whatever it is. It is really good.
I'd say that all the way.
That's the best
Kong
aspect
well.
Of the film, is
I think,
the special effects.
Kong is, because usually you can tell when something's CGI and when there are giant CGI monsters, like you say.
Yeah.
Kong just feels like a real ape the whole way through, and there is no better way.
There were some parts where the green screening
wasn't
quite, but the actual things that were created CGI-wise were incredible. There was sometimes where there was like that separation between actor and thing, but they were great, and in very close second place was Rogue One.
Which was also great.
And then the rest were actually more or less at the bottom. Yeah. So Rogue One and Skull Island were the two we put there. I have a feeling Kubo might have won that one if people knew whether Kubo was animation or special effects.
Yeah.
But no one does. It's just it's a thing. Next we have last technical category, costume design. Save the best to last. So the nominees for costume design are Fantastic Beasts and Where to Find Them.
Like I said.
Hail Caesar! The Nice Guys. Arrival. Ghost in the Shell. And La La Land.
What? I'm not trying to pick anything. What costumes were there in Arrival besides the orange
suits?
I didn't pick Arrival.
I just thought that the costumes... The sci-fi kind of
touched
up.
I might have forgotten.
Was quite cool. I'm probably mainly thinking of the spacesuits, but
A couple of others that got mentioned in this category were the Hunt for the World of People and Free Fire.
Interesting. I didn't
Free Fire suits were really cool.
Who chucked Ghost in the Shell in there? Because I didn't think of that, actually. I think that's quite a good one, yeah.
But I do think
also production design as well on that one's good.
It's worth, you know, you sort of jump... We'll often jump to the obvious choice, which is, a period drama.
Yeah.
Sometimes, actually...
Well, my number one wasn't a period drama.
Yeah.
That's actually the reason I put Fantastic Beasts in there, because I thought it was quite a nice spin on the classic period drama, because it's wizard fantasy, but also period fantasy.
I
thought it was quite creative.
I just hated it so much.
I think as much as I agree with what you said about just because you don't like the film doesn't mean you shouldn't win these categories, I hate that film so much
that
I just like, I fucking hate you.
I was thinking costume, I've put it in for costume, yet there is someone's costume at the end that makes me so angry. Yes. I was like, almost, oh, they fucked that up so bad. Like, should this be
I get where you're coming from, but I thought my main impression of everything about how that film looked was that it looked fucking dull.
Mm.
Including the production design and the costumes. It just looked blah.
Yeah.
Anyway, the winner is The Nice Guys.
Yay.
It won something. Yay. It actually won something.
Shane Black can come over and accept his award anytime he likes.
Which he wouldn't be collecting because he didn't make the costume.
Still, it's his film.
But that was a film that we all particularly liked at the time when we saw it anyway.
Yeah.
So I'm glad.
And they are good costumes. They're part of
some of the real fun and the joy of that film as well.
Yeah.
Like, especially like the party kind of scene and stuff, all the kind of outfits and things going on.
I think me and Jack were did you put La La Land in? Because I put La La Land as mine one. It might have been just me and you. Because a lot of people say, oh, but they're just wearing normal clothes. They're not wearing normal clothes. Where the fuck do you see people dressed like that in the street? Where the fuck do you live? Anyway,
I liked the costumes in La La Land.
So did I. They're beautiful.
Great.
Everything about the film is beautiful. Next film we have...
He's like mellowed or something this year.
He's mellowed. Yeah, like a minute ago he was like, where the fuck do you live? Mellowed.
I still think that relatively there's less rage.
Relative to when?
Next up we have leading actor. And the nominees for leading actor are Ryan Gosling in La La Land, Ryan Gosling in The Nice Guys, James McAvoy in Split, Casey Affleck in that one where he's moody, Hugh Jackman in Logan, and what was the other one? Fucking Andrew Garfield in Hacksaw Ridge. The winner is Ryan Gosling in La La Land.
Because he's charming as fuck.
I didn't actually put that down. I was the only person that didn't put that down.
Really? I don't know why he wasn't such a contender at
I put him down, but he was my number... No, he wasn't my number one. I put him down for Ryan Gosling and The Nice Guys, though. But I didn't put him down for that.
To be fair, he won the Golden Globe, didn't he?
Yeah, but the thing is, like, Emma Stone is treated as, like, the out-and-out, like, obvious winner.
Yeah.
And then Ryan Gosling... I'm not disputing anything here, but I'm just talking mainly about Matt. But for some reason, Ryan Gosling, I felt, was just like second into that. But like,
I think
he had to learn. He does the piano. He does the singing, and
it's because she gets audition.
Yeah, true.
That's why.
But why can't they both?
And it's all political.
Logan was very close.
Yeah,
because it is the best he has ever been in that.
Like, yeah, exactly. Yeah, it's like his swan song.
I think it's the best he's ever been ever.
I was genuinely like, wow, this isn't just good for a superhero acting.
I was genuinely fucking upset by the end, like so upset.
Yeah, and like he does really, really, really convincingly pull off just tired and defeated, and like I just don't want to do this anymore. It's a fun film.
And his final scene with Patrick Stewart as well.
Like I say, upset.
It's a really weirdly powerful film.
Mm.
So, leading actress. The nominees are Amy Adams for Arrival, Jane Levy, I think I've said that right, for Don't Breathe.
I didn't.
Oh.
Hmm.
All right, what about Christopher Lloyd?
Controversial.
I just thought that was a weird one.
You fucking nominated Don't Breathe and lead actor.
The nominee.
Yeah, because Stephen Lang's great.
Oh, I know.
Anyway, I Daniel Blake for The Woman, because agreed that was leading.
Yeah. Right.
That there was some confusion there. Rebecca Hall in your shitty film.
Christie.
What was that
in
film?
In Christie.
Yeah.
Have you seen it?
No, but she's meant to have been
She's amazing
that.
In it. Honestly, it's the only thing I remember about that film. The film itself is quite, like, dead behind the eyes, but she's amazing in it. Like, really amazing.
Viola Davis in Fences, and Emma Stone for La La Land. And the winner's Emma Stone for La La Land. If James put her at number one, I think it was James, it would have been perfect.
All right.
Like,
number one.
You put Hayley, whatever, for Daniel Blake.
Yeah.
Politics.
I think she did have one really great scene with the one.
I think it was James. It might have been Chris. I don't know.
That's sort of the one that's cited quite a lot.
Was it you?
The one that the food bag. Yeah.
Because, I said, I felt she's more of a support role, even though she's a very central support role.
Mm. Yeah,
I know what you mean.
But yes, Emma Stone would have been number one for everyone if it weren't for somebody.
Do you mean Amy Adams would have been?
No, I mean Emma Stone would have been number one. No, as in we all put Emma Stone at number one except for one person who I don't remember who was.
That was me. I think you already named them.
I think it was James, but it might have been this prick as well.
It was me, because I put Amy Adams at number one.
Oh, did you? Okay, there you go.
There we go.
Okay. There you go. This is such a joyful ceremony. I wish they did that at the Oscars. Like, you want that prick down there?
Just have a panel that just sit there and bicker with each other.
But Emma Stone is really, 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 really good.
Mm-hmm.
She's funny. She's charming. And
she's a great dancer.
And she's a good singer. I don't know why everyone picks on her.
She was a close second for me.
I think the thing is, like, people pick on her because a lot of the time with
musical... Because a musical comes out and then everyone's suddenly a fucking X Factor judge.
People compare the musicals to, like, Broadway musicals when they're very, very different. Like, Broadway musicals are all about the songs. Because La La Land's more about, like, movie musicals, more about the emotions, the acting.
Well, also, when it's a Broadway musical, they're literally on stage, so they have to belt it out so everyone hears it. It's different with a musical. You can get, like, audition is the perfect example
really
of that, because you can get right up close.
Yeah. Best director.
Ooh.
The nominees for best director. I might have to guess some of the names, because I've just put the films down.
Yeah.
So, Damien Chazelle for La La Land. Mel Gibson for Hacksaw Ridge. Taika Waititi for Hunt for the World. Did I do that right?
Yeah, he did that really well.
Denis Villeneuve.
Close enough.
Denis Villeneuve.
Dennis the Menace.
Fede Alvarez for Don't Breathe. These are tough and I'm nailing them. Jordan Peele for Get Out. James Mangold. That was the easiest one. For Logan. And Chad Stahelski or something for John Wick.
Oh, Chad Stahelski.
There we go.
I think that's his name. Was he the one? Because David Leitch was the other one. He wasn't on John Wick 2.
It's Chad the one that does.
Yeah.
Chad stayed.
We're referring to
Chad stayed.
Because David Leitch is off doing Deadpool 2, I guess. Yeah.
Okay. And the winner for Best Director is Damien Chazelle.
Such
that one's worth a clap.
I can't.
Second place is
Dennis.
Then Fede Alvarez.
Yeah. Huh? I think Don't Breathe was, like, above everything, a brilliantly directed film. Like,
sure.
Yeah.
I didn't mean that sounds like that sounded sarcastic. Yeah. I meant it. I wasn't like
because like the script's good, but it's not like awards worthy, and the acting's good, but it's not.
It's not awards worthy.
Stephen Lang is his top contender
for the fucking thing.
Fuck off, Stephen Lang's great. But above everything, it is a really well directed film.
Finally, we joke that this has gone on for so long, but this is like by the Oscars stat we'd be up to like the third fucking category.
Yeah.
Is best film, and the nominees for best film are La La Land, Logan, John Wick 2, I, Daniel Blake, The Nice Guys, Arrival, Life on the Road.
That's this year's fury, isn't it?
Moonlight.
Two very close films. Let's see.
And the winner is La La Land.
Yay!
Well, I'm not going to do the joke, don't worry.
Okay.
And what were
just,
the other
ones? There's
what
no
was...
like, oh, I meant Logan. It's just it's La La Land.
What was the rest of the top three?
What's next?
Yeah.
I, Daniel Blake is second.
Oh, yes.
No, it's not.
I was about to give you a lecture there.
No!
You were doing so well!
You weren't doing the joke. You
did. I wasn't prepared with Runners Up. I didn't do that part of the list. The second place was Arrival.
Right.
Third place might be I, Daniel Blake. Yeah, the third place is I, Daniel
Which
Blake.
I'm glad, because you all raised your eyebrows.
No, it's a good film.
It won best British film at the BAFTAs.
It's
so.
A good, good film. It's the one Ken Loach film that I genuinely
I'm
like.
Looking forward for all the looks of the camera. I'm looking forward to that.
So that was
is that?
So
that was the Reelies.
We 2017 and spluttered our way through.
And just added to the pile of awards.
Does anyone want to throw in any other dishonourable mentions?
Oh, we could do that. That might be fun.
Yeah. Power Rangers.
For what?
Fuck everything.
Was it that bad?
Acting was fine, and the directing was okay. But, like, the screenplay is one of the most horrendous things I've ever read in my life, ever.
Well, I would like to nominate Max Landis for worst screenplay, because it was fucking irritating as shit.
Is Me, Him, Her this year?
It was like April time on it. Me, Him, Her's got a horrible, horribly obnoxious screenplay. And I would also put... I know we keep hitting on Suicide Squad here, but Jared Leto for supporting actor. That is a dishonourable as fuck mention.
Also, I found a film that might well be one of my least favourite films of, like, ever. Let alone just, like, the last few years. You heard of a film called Army of One?
No.
It's one of these, like, really crap Nick Cage films. But he plays... It's like a comedy by Larry Charles, the guy that made Borat and Bruno. So it might actually be quite good.
And the Bob Dylan film that you...
Yeah. But it's cool. It's based on this real-life American dude who's, like, proper white bread, like, Republican American, who, after 9/11, flew to Pakistan by himself with a samurai sword and tried to hunt down Bin Laden.
This sounds familiar.
It's a true story. But, like, he tried to hunt down Bin Laden by himself.
Is this true?
Yeah, it's based on a true story, and the film is, like, based on that. But... like, when I actually looked up the character, the real-life guy afterwards, because I was like, there's no way he's this obnoxious. And he wasn't anywhere near as obnoxious as Nick Cage made him. It's one of those films where, like, everything he does is bonkers and bullshit, makes no sense. And
it would be one of my favourite films.
He should be locked up in an insane asylum for. But everyone around him goes, that's a great idea, you do that, you go follow your dreams. You go charge into certain death. And it's basically the whole film is just him bouncing back and forth between America and Pakistan for like 2 hours.
This sounds amazing. Is he recommending this?
It's one of those films that really tries to be funny and it's not even remotely funny. Like, I'll show you a clip when we're done, and it's just, you can tell just from the trailer alone how awful it is.
I think the cinematography one for me would be Jason Bourne again. Because, again, it's the shaky cam, Paul Greengrass style, but just done, like, turned up to 11.
Just doesn't work.
To a way where it's just like, I can't tell what the fuck is going on. How am I meant to enjoy any of this?
Actually, on...
I thought we were moving away from that.
No, dishonourable mention as well on cinematography, actually. T2 Trainspotting. Oh my god. Really? Like, the cinematography, they go, oh yeah, Trainspotting 1. Oh, it's got a reputation as a cult and edgy film. So let's just do that all with weird-ass angles all the time in all the shots in
T2. I feel like it was trying to be too close to Trainspotting 1.
But generally as a film, but I feel like they're really overt with the whole nostalgia thing and like self-aware about that, so I can deal with that. But it's more the fact that in the original, you wouldn't say there's too much striking cinematography for the most part, not in the way that there is in the sequel. For some reason, the sequel just suddenly has all these really weird-ass camera angles and stuff like that.
So, moving to a close, should we just quickly choose a film that we are most looking forward to?
Okay.
In the coming year.
As in, to the end of 2017 or including...
So this time next year...
Just forever. Just forever. A film we are looking forward to. One day coming out.
Because it's difficult to say, because the thing is, this time last year, we probably didn't know anything about half the films that then emerged in the Oscars.
Well, and not only that, but the films that I ended up picking... are not the films that I would have put down.
Yeah.
No way, I would have fucking expected La La Land to be my favourite film in a million
the
years.
The ones you hear about always
don't quite live up to the...
The ones that you hear about months in advance are just the big, you know, the superhero films. Mm-hmm. Like Wonder Woman. When's that coming out?
I thought it was March, but it's been coming out. June?
Yeah. It is June! It comes out in June!
The fictional month of June!
So I'm looking forward to this because... Chris has a historical precedent of doing this really badly. Terminator Salvation.
Terminator Genesis, which was actually alright in the end.
It wasn't as bad as I expected. Arnie dive bombs a helicopter.
That was innovative.
This is like our train spotting too. We're like revisiting the past.
Nostalgia.
Okay.
Right, so what's your pick?
Oh, well, Again, it is hard because they are just going to be inevitably the bigger films.
I don't know, because part of me wants to say Kingsman 2, but that's I'm more worried about that than I am excited.
Born again, though.
It is, and that's what kind of makes me think he's not fucked up yet when he himself has been directing.
Kick-Ass 2 was bad because Matthew Vaughn didn't direct it.
My point is, like, I'm worried, though, because it's, I don't know, Colin Firth coming back as a... Really? I'm worried, so I'm not going to put that as my most anticipated, even though I kind of want it to be my favourite. I think I will say Alien Covenant. No! You know what one's jumped up now because of the trailer? It.
Yeah, It looks really, really good, actually.
It looks really good.
I'm surprised, yeah.
I'm going to say It. The first It is horrible. First It is
really,
a terrible film.
It's really, really slow. It's far, far, far
And then
long.
It's the second half of it is utterly stupid.
Yeah, it's awful.
But this is based on the Loser Club, which is... Because obviously the book's fucking huge. Mm. And the Loser Club is the first half when they're just kids.
Yeah.
I don't know if this means there's going to be a second film.
They're planning
that
so they can potentially sequel it.
But either way, it might mean that there's one film that's just the good parts.
Yeah.
And the trailer was so surprisingly not shit.
Yeah.
So I'm going to say It.
That's fair.
It was a weird choice.
Okay.
Jack? I'm just going to be very generic because I can't remember anything else coming out and just say The Last Jedi. Because it just makes me happy seeing Star Wars in the cinema again. And it's, regardless of how everyone views was it The Force Awakens a year after it came out or whatever, I still remember sitting in the cinema and hearing the Star Wars theme again. And I know it's just... You could argue that it's just a nostalgia thing, but it's still fun just to sit down and get that again.
I'm looking forward to that for the fact that it is one of the core films, because I just never really properly respected Rogue One, maybe, for that reason.
So. It's seeing the opening crawl, knowing you're watching a proper Star Wars movie again.
Well, for me, it's like I still love The Force Awakens. I don't mind that it's a soft reboot, nostalgia, whatever.
I love it. Yeah.
It'll be nice to take those characters that were set up in and then now do something with
proper,
them.
Yeah.
Like, I liked how the trailer, instead of being like, remember this, remember that, it was actually about
the
new people and what's
happening
with them. And that was like, oh, cool, because I did like them and now I want to see where they can go in that on their own.
I mean, my most anticipated is 100% Last Jedi, because I love Rian Johnson. Guardians is a very close second. Guardians Volume 2, I'm very, very hyped about, but obviously that's literally weeks away.
Mm-hmm.
But looking further down the line as well, Marvelness, Thor Ragnarok looks... I never expected the first poster, the first trailer, all the kind of like title cards and stuff. Thor Ragnarok just looks incredible. I really did not expect to be so excited for it, but not just Jeff Goldblum and not just Taika Waititi, but everything about like the Planet Hulk elements, the 80s fantasy elements, the kind of promises of Midnight Run style buddy cop stuff. It just looks great. So.
What's also quite interesting, I just realised about that, is that's potentially the last of the original Phase 1
standalone
trilogies, if that makes sense, in terms of we had Iron Man 1-3, we've had Captain America 1-3, and we now
is there not
going to
be
a
Captain America?
They might further down the road, but like in terms of their slate, that's not necessarily a thing, which
that's
is quite interesting.
That's very true, actually.
But they're like, it's almost like Phase 1 is fully tied
in
a way.
We'll be left with all our new favourites like Ant-Man,
Falcon, the Wasp.
Ant-Man.
Oh, yeah, Ant-Man and the Wasp. Ant-Man 2 is a thing. that was going to be a joke. Well. Shit.
Vision, Black Panther, and more.
And more is my favourite.
Saber for Ragnarok.
What about the Hawkeye standalone movie that might one day happen that they always ask Jeremy Renner about, even though it's never going to happen?
Because no one
that
wants it.
That must just be like an awkward party question you fucking hate at Christmas.
He gets
like,
it every
so,
interview.
Jeremy, when are you getting your standalone?
Is it actually a genuine question, or is it more like a taunt? Jared, when's Hawkeye? It's not. No, where's Hawkeye?
At least with the
Black Widow. Even Arrow's got a TV show, but you don't have a...
At least the Black Widow standalone movie is a possibility.
Hawkeye Legacy, or was Born Legacy, or
something? Oh, Born Legacy. Can you take over Mission Impossible? That's not happening.
What are you?
Right. In terms of my, I wouldn't say necessarily most anticipated, but obviously I'm hoping that both Alien Covenant and the new Blade Runner are going to be good, but I'm not letting myself get excited for them just because they're both, you know, pretty difficult to surpass, so I'm not, I haven't got high hopes.
Do you not think that Alien is sort of like, the bar with Alien is now so low that it doesn't matter, like just be better than AVP Requiem.
That's true. It's definitely a case of I'm not expecting it to be better than Alien, because it's not going to be better than Alien, but what I want is an enjoyable good Alien
just
film.
Just be good.
Like,
be the third best Alien film is what you're saying.
Be the second.
Even the fourth.
Like an Alien. Dreams.
Yes, it could be. It won't, but...
what you were saying is, I'm not going to get my hopes up, but high hopes!
I'm just saying, like, believe. shorter term, it's actually already out, but I'm looking forward to actually seeing City of Tiny Lights, which is...
Oh, right, the Riz Ahmed.
Kind of neo-noir set in London with Riz Ahmed, and it's really cool. It looks like a good film, but apart from that, I can't think of any other big ones. Four... looking forward to, I think, because that's like the dark horse of the Marvel slate at the moment. Mm. And then the trailer, everyone's just like, oh my god, it's...
I didn't think the trailer was as good as everyone's
making it. No, I didn't either. I'm excited just because it looks, because it will be cool.
Exactly.
Taika Waititi and the people attached, but I didn't think the trailer was
I still felt the trailer's holding something back a little bit.
It felt
bit,
like the trailer for a normal Marvel movie.
Yeah. And everyone's just like, oh, now Thor's funny. That's different.
He was always funny. That was his thing in the first one.
Yeah, but they forgot about that.
Yeah.
I was a bit taken aback by it because I thought they were going to go full Ragnarok, have it like full Thor fantasy, but they've actually done Thor.
Well, they did full
fantasy
and
with the Dark World. They've gone sci-fi with it, taking it into kind of Guardians realm, haven't they? And stuff.
Which makes sense. Connect up the universe.
Yeah.
Go for it, James.
So kind of jumping on what you're saying about Blade Runner there. So... normally I maybe have one film that I'm really looking forward to of a year, but this year there are two, and I honestly could not pick which one it was going to be. Mm. Because Blade Runner, when it was announced that there was going to be a sequel, I thought, oh no, that's not a film that there should be a sequel for. Why is everything getting a sequel?
But then it's
Denis Villeneuve, who is amazing, like one of my favourite directors, and that was before I saw Arrival, and then I see Arrival, and it's a really well-done, thoughtful sci-fi film. Yeah. And Roger Deakins, and Ryan Gosling... and Harrison Ford.
And Jared Leto.
Yeah.
Oh, is he in it?
He is.
Yeah.
I just hope he's not the kind
I just hope that Denis Villeneuve has like enough balls to just go, Jared, fuck off. Say your lines. Stop being a tick.
No, you can't play on the soundtrack.
Take that condom out of the dressing room.
So I don't know. I've got very high hopes for it, and I don't want to be disappointed, so I'm a bit scared about that.
Yeah.
So I'm also going to throw in the fact that one of my absolute favourite directors is making a Second World War film, and that is fucking awesome.
I forgot about that.
And the trailer, it looks really good. It looks like it's been done in a kind of like a respectful way, if that makes sense. It's not over the top.
Yeah.
I know we were talking yesterday about the fact that Harry Styles is in it, and that's awful.
Harry Styles has single-handedly made me have no interest in the film.
Really?
But that's just like, the fact that people like object to him as a person.
I'm sure the director will just, as a concept.
I really think that Harry Styles is going to be such a minor part
that's
of it.
That's the thing. Like, I couldn't even spot him in the trailer.
You know, that Tom Hardy...
Kenneth Branagh,
Killian
Murphy, Mark Rylance.
Yeah,
I question if all of those put together are enough to undo Harry Styles.
Well, Harry Styles, you can't even notice where he is in the trailer. They don't name check him at any point. He's not going
to
be.
He's
it's not
going to
be like Dunkirk starring Harry Styles.
Exactly.
I don't disagree with that.
Yeah.
But anyway, Dunkirk, that's out in July.
Yeah.
Is it?
So I'm very excited for that. So I'm probably going to go with that over Blade Runner purely because Blade Runner, I'm scared.
Yeah.
So.
And someone described Dunkirk as like Chris Nolan's David Lean film, which would be like an interesting, because when you look at it, does look very like almost dated considering it's coming out this year.
So, lots of like long shots.
Yeah, very few special effects. It does look good.
Mm. Should I give you a load of camera of cutaways for the camera like you want?
Yes.
We're going to do
reaction shots.
Basically, every time. No, basically, every time you talked, I would turn to do it like an office look to the camera, and now they're lost.
Should I do the cut?
Yeah, sure.
So,
That was the Reelies 2017 edition.
Whew. That was a big one.
I'm pooped.
Exhaustive. and hopefully we'll be back in 12 months' time, having seen lots more good films.
We've sold us.
I think that's sold it, yeah. Well, thank you very much for listening.
Bye!
Ciao.
Toodaloo.
What? That's a great one.
Top notch. Oh.